Okay. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. ASIS International presents Ask Me Anything, excuse me, about the recertification application process, a presentation by the ASIS Professional Certification Board, or PCB. Thank you for joining. I'm Erica Brown, the Director of Certification at ASIS and today's moderator. We have a great program ahead, but a few reminders. If you have a question during the presentation, please type it in the Q&A widget and we will address as many as possible as time permits at the end. Today's presentation is being recorded and attendees will be messaged when the recording is available. All microphones will be muted throughout the presentation. Thank you again for joining today's webinar, Ask Me Anything about the recertification application process. I'd like to now introduce today's speakers. Jeff Leonard, CPP, PSP, has established himself as a trusted risk advisor with 35 years of experience in military, security, and integrated systems technology leadership and management. He has developed significant expertise in global critical infrastructure and corporate environments, protecting assets through advanced technology capabilities and innovative solution applications. He works well at aligning solutions with organizational business objectives, cultures, and risk profiles. Jeff has an exceptional ability to lead and elevate teams to operational and professional excellence, and he is skillful at collaborating and influencing internal and external strategic partnerships. Jeff joined ASIS in 1992 and is currently finishing his sixth year as director on the Professional Certification Board. Also joining us today is Janine One-Schmidt, ICE CCP. Janine is a certification specialist with 12 years of experience, and from 2011 through 17, Janine was a certification manager for the Certified Meeting Professional, CMP. She came to ASIS in 2017 as a certification specialist and at that time earned her Certified Credentialing Professional Certification, ICE CCP, in October 2021. She is well-versed in all aspects of the CPP, PSP, PCI, and APP certifications and recertification, including policies, procedures, application processes, exam development, and test administration. Hello to our panel, and thank you for joining us today. And with that, the floor is yours.
Good morning. So while the ASIS staff implement policies and procedures, they work closely with the Professional Certification Board, or the PCB. The PCB directors are required to be ASIS certified, and they serve up to two consecutive three-year terms. Our current PCB directors represent all four of the certifications, six countries, and many industries and specialties. The hardest part of certification is actually understanding where to start, but ASIS does make it easy. The first document you should download and read is a recertification guide. It contains information regarding continuing education activities allowed, the documentation required, limits on continuing education hours for some activity types, and recent policy changes. Most questions that certificants ask have been answered in the recertification guide. The basics for what we do in the certification and recertification are that it's an online application only. All recertification education information is due by the end of the certification cycle. It's 60 continuing professional education units per cycle. You submit and pay the fee, and then there will be a review anytime in the third year of your certification. If you keep your email up to date, it makes everything a lot easier because that's how things get delivered information-wise. We'll cover these more in detail throughout this presentation. But that is the basic. ASIS does send reminders in the last year of your recertification cycle. So again, that's why it's so important to make sure you keep your email current. The key to recertification is completing your required 60 CPEs. Understanding the intent of the requirement can guide you as you choose professional development activities. To qualify for ASIS recertification, your ASIS recertification cycle, the activity must be security or business management related and not part of your regular job duties. For other domains, the activity must align with the body of knowledge for your certification. All continuing professional education credit must be earned within your three-year recertification cycle. Hours earned before or after your cycle dates will not count. So there are a maximum number for some of the activities. 24 CPEs is the most you can get for membership credits. There are 30 CPEs as a maximum for instructor, and 30 as a volunteer. Public service activities must be security related and be performed pro bono. If you aren't sure something will count, you can email the ASIS certification team and they can assist in clarifying that.
The 8 credit types are outlined in the recertification guide. Watch for maximum caps for membership, instructor, and volunteer credit types. Safety-related programs cap at 21 credits max per three-year certification cycle. Safety-related programs can fall under education, instructor, and other accomplishments. So what do you need to report CPEs? You need to know what was the activity, when it took place, how long was the activity, and what domain does it align with? So now that you know what you need to report, next I will review how you need to report your CPEs. I will be covering the details you need to have available to self-report your CPE activities. So when did it take place? Each activity must have taken place during your three-year cycle, and the date must be included in documentation that comes from the host. How long was the activity? Activities can be 30 minutes or longer, and you can report in 15-minute increments. You should not include meals, networking, or breaks. And when you're reporting an activity that's less than 1 hour, the leading zero is needed when reporting that activity. What domain does it align with? The body of knowledge for each certification is in the recertification guide. Include the domain alignment so that this ASIS staff can easily understand the domain alignment when reviewing your application. The required documentation. Documentation cannot be your request to register for an event or a registration receipt. Documentation should include proof of attendance, which includes a certificate of attendance, name badge from the event, or a letter from the organizer confirming your attendance. Please don't upload email messages. If you want to include an email, please first screenshot that email and save it as a Word or PDF document. Documents should not be larger than 4 megabytes. And I guess the biggest tip, if you have a large document, is to save it as a reduced size PDF, and then you can upload that.
So where to obtain the CPEs? There are a lot of avenues for ASIS members to earn CPEs directly from ASIS. ASI volunteer activities include board, chapter, and community positions. CPEs can be earned through standards and guideline activities. There are just a number of things that automatically get credited to your account. There are low and no cost activities that ASIS sponsors. A lot of the pre-approved things are domain pre-selected. GSX attendance, again, if you go as an attendee and have the all access pass, you get a good number of credits there, and that automatically posts within 6 to 8 weeks after the event. There's a number of different opportunities to participate in certification exam development and body of knowledge and a plethora of activity that goes on around certification and reviews of each of the different types. So it seems like a never-ending opportunity to participate in some of these activities for certification that help you with your CPEs.
So you may self-report activities for any of the credit types. However, the most used is the education credit types. You can self-report activities from other providers. The activities must be security or business related and must align with the domains of the certification you are recertifying. You will need proof of attendance and the agenda or course description that shows the date and time of the course or session. A transcript is the required documentation for college or university courses that you complete within your 3-year cycle. For other certifications, you will not receive credit for recertification of an approved certification. Only the initial certification that is completed within the current 3-year cycle can be submitted.
So ASIS and the PCB have actually established a pre-approved preferred provider program. Preferred provider directory includes companies, organizations, or chapters that have had their courses or classes or session pre-approved by ASIS. Preferred providers can use the special PPP logo on their approved offerings. One thing that's important to know is that self-reported CPEs stay in pending status until your recert application is submitted. The PPP CPE credits will be approved during the review. So again, pre-approved for CPE credit when you're on the PPP list, and you still must self-report with the supporting documentation that Janine talked about previously.
So how to submit? You can upload documentation for self-reported CPE at any time in your recertification cycle. Activities will stay in the pending status until you submit the recertification application. If you have any questions about what may count for CPE, we are happy to answer those. We'll share our email address at the end of the presentation. Okay, now we're going to switch over to the website and walk you through the recertification application portal and show you where you can find some other important resources. Can everybody see my screen? Hope so.
Yes.
Awesome. So on the main website of ASIS, if you click on the certification heading and then go to recertification and scroll down a little bit, this is where you can download the recertification guide. The recertification will show you all the different credit types and the documentation required, as well as all the policies for the recertification program. If you scroll down the page a little bit further, you will see a How Do I Recertify section. There's another link to the recertification guide. And then you can click on this where it says View Instructions for Uploading Credits and Submitting your certification application. This will give you step-by-step instructions that will walk you through logging on, how to self-report CE credits. If you go back up to the certification heading and you click on the preferred provider program, you can scroll down to the preferred provider directory. On the directory, you will see the current list of our preferred providers, and you can click on each one of these to get to their offerings. So now I'm going to go to see if I am logged in. Okay, so now I want to show you how you can log in to your recertification application. First, you're going to click login. I don't know if that's going to go to the right page. Okay, I'm already logged in. So you will, to log into your ASIS account, you're going to use the email address that's associated with your ASIS account and the password that you created. And once you've logged in, you'll see your name at the top of the screen and under, and then you can go to click on My Information and then My Account. This is going to take you to your profile page. And on your profile page, you will click on My Certifications. If you have an open application that you're not certified in, it will show up here. Or if you don't have any open ones, they will show you the ones that you can apply for. But if you scroll down a little bit, you'll see under My Certifications, you'll see your open recertification application, and you click Certification Details. And then you want to click on the CPE credits. If you've never been in here before, then you need to calculate the hours, and this will kind of sync everything up. To report a CE credit, CE activity, you can click on Report CE. We'll choose the different credit type. Enter the domain. Under the sponsor, if it's not an ASIS preferred provider, you will select the first not an ASIS preferred provider. If it's you're self-reporting something that was from ASIS International, you can click that. And if it was one of the preferred providers, you can choose it from this list. And then you're going to enter the activity name. I'm just making one up as we go along here. And then you will enter the number of credits. If you're going to enter six hours, then you can enter it as 6.00. If it was less than six, if it was a half hour, then you would list that as 0.50. And then you would want to put the date in. Then you would give a brief description. And then you're going to upload your file. After you've done that, you can, if you have other additional files, you can upload two more. You can upload up to three and then click save. Once you have completed 60 required credits, you're within 1 year of your certification end date, you will see a submit application button. Click on that button. You will read through the eligibility questions and you will either click I have nothing to disclose or I have something to disclose. If you check the box that says I have something to disclose, please type out some additional information. And once you submit your application, we'll be in touch with you about that. Once you're finished with that part, click next, and you're going to sign the attestation. Once you've signed the attestation, click agree, and then you will go on to complete the payment and submit your application. So I'm going to stop share. Go back here. So if you've gone to the end of your certification end date, you have a 3-month grace period called the lapse period after your end date.
Apologies for interrupting. We can't see your screen.
Oh, you cannot see my screen. I'm sorry. I clicked it, but didn't hit share. So my apologies. So on at the end of your three-year certification cycle, you if you haven't submitted your application, you do have a three-month grace period to submit that application. Late fees do apply. Your CPEs all had to have taken place within the three-year cycle. So this is not the time to add new CPE credits that took place out of your three-year cycle, but it is the time that you can report activities that you did complete within the three-year cycle. Once the certification application has been submitted, it goes into the staff's cycle for review. Typically, within 2 to 3 weeks after you've submitted your recertification application, our staff will complete the review. The reviewer will look at each activity to ensure that it aligns with the domains of the certification you are recertifying and that the required documentation has been uploaded. Some common errors that occur: uploading an email message because we can't open it, uploading a registration receipt or an invitation to attend an activity, or not entering the correct number of credits for the activity. Another common error is self-reporting an activity that has already been reported for you if it was an ASIS activity. So please be careful of that, because that way, if you do that, then it kind of double dips and we will reject the self-reported activity for that reason. So what are the fees? How much does the recertification application cost? Well, that depends. If you're a member and it's within your three-year cycle, the member rate is 170. The emerging markets 1 and 2 are also shown if you happen to be in a country where the world markets, emerging market countries are listed. Non-members will pay $210. If you're in your grace period, you do pay a late fee, and ASIS members are $250. And non-members are $290. There are a lot of benefits to ASIS membership. For recertification purposes, your webinars are free. If you are interested in another certification and you want to get books to help study for those, or you just are interested in one of the ASIS standards and guidelines, if you get that in ebook format, it is free if you're a member. You also receive member rates for other ASIS educational offerings, recertification, pursuing another certification, and GSX 2024. ASIS Connects is an online forum for members. Along with the open forum, there are 39 subject area communities in many industry areas where you can connect to network and learn.
So now we talk about multiple certifications. As a holder of multiple ASIS certifications, I wanted to share the process for CPE management for all of them. So each must be recertified separately. Often the CPEs align with more than one certification, so they actually apply across. ASIS related activities will be loaded in each application, and each certification has individual end dates. The self-reported CPE activities will need to be uploaded to each of the certifications. We really have tried to make it as simple as possible, and it does really help that each of the education opportunities applies separately to each certification you hold.
Okay, thank you, Jeff and Janine, for your presentation. Before we move to answer the submitted questions, those that were submitted in advance and those in the chat and Q&A, please remember to continue submitting them so we have lots to talk about in the remaining time. Please try to keep your questions focused on the recertification process. If you have a question or concern about your specific recertification, please contact us offline at the email that is shown on the screen so we can get you a personalized response. So with that, Janine and Jeff, I'm ready with some questions for you. First one up, how long does it take for me to receive an updated certification once my recertification has been completed?
So I will take that one. After the certification staff completes the review, we update your Credly badge that you get within 2 to 4 weeks. Typically, we do that every 2 weeks to once a month, depending on the number that we're recertifying. And then in the Credly instructions, you will also have instructions on how to claim your digital badge and print your certificate.
Fantastic. And I put the link to Credly in the chat for everybody to access. Next one, when completing an activity under the public service category, such as threat risk assessment for a community non-for-profit organization, how do we know how many credits to ask for in the letter from the board? As an example, this particular activity represents about 56 hours of pro bono work.
I guess I will answer that one as well. You would submit those 56 hours in a letter, and you would need to like outline, maybe not hour for hour, but a timeline of what you accomplished, so that when we do send it to the PCB Certificate Relations Committee for review, they can clearly see the work that you've done. And then if it truly is the 56 hours, then you will be awarded that.
Fantastic. Thank you. Janine, we have a clarification on the percentage bar that was in the portal. Can you confirm how often that percentage bar gets reported? Will it show the total number of hours before they submit their application or only after they've submitted and items have been reviewed?
So you will always see the number of reported CE credits. And then, but if you have non-ASIS activities, the approved part of it will probably not show up as approved until after we've reviewed it. Once you've completed the 60 or more credits required, then that bar should represent 100%. The key is not really looking at the bar, though. It is looking to see if you see that submit application button at the top. If you have reported at least 60 credits and you are within 1 year of your certification cycle end date, that blue submit application will appear and then you can click that.
Great, thank you. Our next one is from the chat. When submitting CPEs, I notice they are not reviewed until the expiration date is over and everything is submitted. At that point, if something is not accepted, it might be too late. Can they be reviewed as they are submitted?
So we don't typically review activities as they're submitted. As you can imagine, that would be putting your hands on everybody's research applications multiple times. However, if you don't feel like you know if it aligned to the domain or if it would be, you can reach out to us at certification@asisonline.org. and ask us to take a look at it. We're happy to do that. And then we can give you some advice if it's not, maybe what else you can do, but we definitely can help you with that.
Great, thank you. If you have completed 100% of the CPE, but we are not at my due date in the recertification process, when do I need to submit?
If you're not at your due date, if you see the blue submit button, you can submit your application. If you're over a year out, then you won't see that blue submit button. You have to be within 1 year of your end date, regardless of whether or not you've gotten to the 60 credits in order to click that blue submit button and submit your application.
Thank you. The slide mentioned that books and eBooks for study are free or at no cost. I'm seeing costs for my APP prep. When do we get the free/no cost study materials? Thank you.
So if you are a member, the ASIS standards and guidelines portion of the APP study materials in ebook format would be available to you at no cost in the ebook format. If you're getting ebooks for the other APP books that are part of the protection of assets, those eBooks do come with a cost. They are not free, but you would, if you're a member, you would get them at the member rate.
Thank you, Janine. When our local ASIS chapter has meetings and the agenda includes a 1 to 2 hour presentation by a security professional, is it possible for that type of presentation to qualify for CPE?
Absolutely. They can definitely, you can definitely submit those. Your chapters should have a certificate of attendance that they can provide to you. We've seen them in different formats, but as you can submit a proof that you attended, and the for 1 or 2 hours, however it is, but that certificate attendance, your chapter education officers should have access to a template that they can produce a certificate and provide to you so you can self-report that.
Great, thank you. Does my ASIS email address need to be the same as my Credly email?
Yes, must be the same, because that is how we upload those. We use your ASIS email address. If you have one that's not the same, and you can contact us, and my colleague Lisa, who's the one who takes care of that, she can switch your badge over to the other email address. But we like to use the ASIS, the email address associated with your ASIS account.
Great, thank you. When holding a committed commitment chair at a local chapter, how do I report all of the hours, like normal chapter activities, volunteer hours, as part of the community relations committee when holding a committee chair? Sorry, didn't scroll far enough.
Jeff, do you want to take that one or do you want me to?
Go ahead. You're on a roll.
Sure. So if you are a member of a committee at the chapter, you get so many volunteer credits for being a member of that committee. You wouldn't necessarily get hour for hour credit for that volunteer, but as a member of an ASIS committee or chapter president, chapter position, you do get volunteer credits per year, and that is outlined under the volunteer activity type in the recertification guide.
Yeah, I can add to that most of the recertification guide does answer a lot of that, but volunteer positions are definitely not on an hour per hour basis. Like sitting on the PCB probably have spent upwards of 120 hours this year, and I think we get 24 volunteer. So it's not a one for one, but the ability to contribute to the organization, the association, is part of the reward for that.
And remember, there are caps on some of the categories you can report your CPE in. So even in the one for one, even if that were possible, you wouldn't be able to count only volunteer hours. So you do have to watch those maximums that I think Jeff had covered earlier. Which actually leads to our next question. Are CEUs required to be from multiple CEU categories?
You don't have to have something from every category. Education, you can have all of them in the education credit type. Education is unlimited. You can have as many of those as you want to. You would not be able to get all your credits from volunteer because it caps at 30, instructors capped at 30. But author, if you're authoring a book or a chapter in a book or an article in a recognized periodical, those kind of credits are unlimited as well.
Great. If you have more things to report, like participation in webinars, conferences, et cetera, but you have completed 100% of your requirements, will that additional training help in the next recertification process?
No, the information actually has to be within the recertification period. So you get a 3-year period for your recertification to earn credits. and all credits earned during that three-year period apply to the recertification for that three-year period.
Great. Thank you, Jeff. In the past, if you reached 60 CPEs via GSX attendance and membership, you were automatically recertified and not need to submit anything. Is that still the case?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that question again?
In the past, if you reached your 60 CPEs via GSX attendance and membership, you automatically were recertified and did not need to resubmit anything or to submit anything. Is that still the case?
I think that there's always been a requirement to submit a recertification application. The CEUs that are earned are automatically reported when it's all from GSX and from membership, and you can get to your 60 during that period, but you still have to initiate the application process to begin the recertification and to pay the fee.
So I can add a little bit to that. Prior to 2018, when we instituted the online application, when we did paper applications, or for recertification, once someone got to the 60 credits, then our ASIS certification staff would send them an invoice just for to pay. So there wasn't per se an application that had to be submitted. But since we instituted the online recertification application process back in 2018, you upload your credits and then you submit that application where you're actually reading the eligibility questions and signing an attestation again and submitting it with your payment. So since 2018, you've had to submit a recertification application with payment.
Great. Is there a maximum CPE credit, amount of CPE credits that can be obtained using webinars?
There is not. You could do all of your credits in webinars. If you wanted to, you can do them. They're under the education credit type, so you could do them all in webinars. It'd be great if you did other things, but you can. Great. No maximum or webinars.
All right. Next one's going back to GSX. When attending GSX, why is there a difference in the amount of credits for an Expo Pass compared to All Access?
So the go ahead, Jeff, absolutely. Go ahead with that one.
So the Expo Pass was for the exhibit hall only, and the All Access Pass actually allows you to attend the education activities. So GSX is a huge hall of technology and security information inside the exhibit hall. But beyond that, in the outer hallways, there's a tremendous amount of education sessions available for attendance and for education and learning.
Great, thank you. I am turning 73 years old and have been certified since 2002. What are the senior member protocols? I think this is asking about lifetime certification. Janine, can you take that?
Yes, so you have to be an active certificant for at least 12 years with no lapses in that, and you have to be fully retired. If you're completely retired, you can email us and we'll send you the lifetime certification application, which you can fill out and send back in to us. There is a $100 one-time fee for lifetime certification. If you are 73 and you're still working, then you are not eligible to become a lifetime certificant.
Great, thank you. How early ahead of my expiration date can my application be submitted?
The earliest
you can submit the application within 12 months of your expiration date.
Yes.
So your expiration date is December 31st of 2023, then January 1st of 2023, you're allowed to submit your application.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Going back to the GSX questions, as a follow-up, no one audits your badge when attending sessions. For example, in Dallas this year, attendance was not collected at any panels or breakouts. There's not really a question in this, but Is there anything that we do to audit that or anything, Janine?
So no, we don't really audit. It is kind of an honor system. So, I mean, if you go and you purchase the all access pass and you're going to attend educational sessions, you will get your 22 credits, I think is what it was this year. We don't go and scan badges and get individual attendance at each of those educational offerings. We assume that people that spend the money to do that all access pass are going to be taking advantage of as much education as they can. So it is a bit of an honor system, but that's the reason why we don't do it.
Great, thank you. If I recertify my current cycle early, can I start earning CEUs for my next recertification cycle?
So no, because your current certification cycle will run through its end date and your new certification cycle will start the day after your other one ends. So you would need to wait until your new certification cycle begin date to start accruing CE credits for that new certification cycle. When you do recertify, the certification staff will send you an email letting you know that you've been recertified and giving you the new three-year cycle and when it starts and when you can submit your CE credits within that time period.
Great. Thank you. Somebody has an expired certification. Can they renew it or do they need to retake the exam?
If your certification is truly expired, then you are past the lapse point and you can't submit your application, then you do need to submit a new certification application and sit for the exam in order to regain your certification.
Great questions, remember that everybody.
If it's within 3 months of it having expired, there is a lapse policy. So you do have an opportunity if it's within 3 months. If it's past the 3 month period after your certification expired, then it is back to the test.
Okay. Keep submitting questions. This is great. I hope it's great, helpful information to everybody on the call. My next one is there any benefit to obtaining more credits than what the required amount is when I'm renewing my certification?
Yes, I think we encourage people to complete and submit more than the 60, and just in the off chance that something you did submit doesn't align with the domains of the certification, or something that you did not report with the correct documentation and can't get that documentation for us, then you would have some other ones to be able to fall back on to make that 60. So we always encourage more credits than the required amount.
Great, thank you. We've talked about GSX a lot. Can you claim CPEs for attending a non-ASIS trade show, such as ISC or IFSEC?
Yes, as long as the content of those sessions that you attend are security related and align with the domains of the certification that you're recertifying, you can certainly submit credit for those. You would need a certificate of attendance or a name badge to prove your attendance and a copy of the session conference agenda that shows the date and time of the session so that the number of credits that you are submitting can be verified.
Fantastic. Thank you. Jose has asked, can you repeat the lifetime certification requirements, Janine?
Currently certified, not lapsed or expired, have held the certification for 12 continuous years, and that you need to be completely retired, not participating, consulting, or anything in a security-related way. Then you can submit a lifetime certification application. The information that outlines the eligibility requirements for that are in the recertification guide, which is available as a PDF on the website.
Great. Janine, can you Within the portal, can you explain what the difference between completed versus pending versus confirmed CPEs status?
So if you've completed the 60 credits, that means you've reported the number of 60. The activities that you self-report remain in a pending status until you submit your application and the staff has been able to review those. Once we've reviewed those self-reported activities and confirmed and verified them, then they, I think they show as completed or verified. I'm not sure which one they show on the outside, but they stay in pending status until you submit your application. Once we've reviewed them, we will mark them as complete and verified.
Fantastic. All right. That is the end of the questions I've seen. So this is your last call. If you have anything else you want to ask, you're welcome to pop it in the chat or the Q&A widget. Yes, I see in the chat that somebody had missed much of the webinar. There will be a video. Once we wrap everything up today and we get the video downloaded and cleaned up a little bit, we will post it and you will all receive an email in a day or two once we're ready to get it out that will include a link to the recording of this session. So anybody who's on today or just registered, so maybe if a coworker missed and they did register, they will also get the link in an email later. All right, I have one more question that just popped up. If you elect to recertify by exam instead of gaining CPEs, are you basically retaking the original certification exam?
You would be retaking the certification exam.
And absolutely. Understand that the exams have different forms, and depending on what happened within the last 5 years, a lot of times the form of that exam can change. So while you may not go through your CPEs, understand that the form of the test, the content in the test, may have altered since you actually took it the first time. But yes, if you don't go through the recertification CPEs, then you are required to take the exam again.
Great questions, everybody. Okay, I think that wraps everything up with the questions. So I'd like to thank Janine and Jeff for your time today and the efforts put into making this a great presentation for everybody. Thank you for all of the engagement by the participants. We've had a lot of great questions and hopefully everybody's walking away with some new information that you didn't have. To our attendees, we hope you enjoyed the presentation. As we've said, this has been recorded and you will receive a note when it's available for you to watch later or to share with coworkers. We hope to see you at our next session, which will be in November. It will be on test taking administration and test taking strategies. It'll be November 17th. So mark your calendars. You will see emails coming out about that a couple weeks in advance. And be sure to share that in the information about that upcoming webinar with colleagues who might benefit from it and encourage them to take their certification exams. So with that, thank you all again for attending, and this does conclude our presentation today.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Jeff. Thanks, Janine.